Funding provided by...
You work hard to feed them well. That's why at Fairway, we're committed to our foundation of personalized service while treating our customers like family and valuing our employees. Fairway Meat and Grocery. That's what we're all about.
By Muskel Lighting, the sports lighting specialists, providing lighting systems for you, your project, and your community.
Small businesses are the backbone of Iowa's communities, and they are backed by Iowa banks. With advice, loans, and financial services, banks across Iowa are committed to showing small businesses the way to a stronger tomorrow. Learn more at iowabankers.com.
Inside Wells Fargo Arena, we are getting ready for a full lineup of high school coverage. It's our second day of live girls basketball championships here on statewide Iowa PBS. We're high above the floor, the lights are on, and we're ready to go. Hello, everybody. I'm Paul Yeager. Throughout the night, Iowa PBS Sports will bring you the games, the highlights, the analysis, and features from right here at our on-site sports desk. But first, we need to jump into tonight's matchups in the 4A, 2A, and 1A championships and show you how those teams all survived the semifinals. Let's begin in Class 4A. Cedar Rapids Xavier knocked out Central DeWitt 62-55, and Dallas Center Grimes rolled by Benton Community on Tuesday morning. Early on for Xavier, Libby Fandel drives in for the layup off the glass. The freshman again is going to catch, release, and score. Dallas Center Grimes, that's Finley Fitzgerald on the drive. Every Korshin up ahead to Josie Lampe. Three, got it. Josie would finish with three. Each team had one field goal in the second quarter. DCG up by four at the break. Xavier, Mason goes coast to coast. Mason with another big shot. Up ahead, this is at the end of regulation and we're going to play overtime. Not once, not two, but three overtimes. Libby Fandel would come up big. She set the tone with this three. First triple overtime game since 2018 at the state tournament and the first of Coach Lilly's 37-year career. Xavier wins by five. Bishop Heelan, well, they knocked out Waverly Shellrock, and Glenwood survived the Bondurant Farrar Blue Jays. Early on for Glenwood, it's Abby Hughes with the three. Hughes off the missed shot, goes right back up after a hard dribble. She finished with 13. And she'd have 23 in the semis. Jada Newberg hits a three. And now Meese to Newberg again for another three. Newberg would have 17. Heelan at the break up by 13. Jenna Hopp and Brinley Arnold going to work for Glenwood, which, by the way, have one of the best mascots of the tournament. And Bishop Heelan, Lauren Peck there with the three. And Peck takes the inbound pass. Four Crusaders in double figures. Peck with 17 as Heelan wins 68-51. We're going to break down all the games. Jackie Kalen is on set again here this afternoon. She'll have a game in a moment. But first, we start with Laura Leonard. She has 4A and 1A. And Laura, you've seen a lot of basketball. You've played a lot of basketball. But you even had some questions about this defense that Bishop Heelan had. The final answer was 1-3-1. It's a little different.
Yeah, well, number one, that's why I don't coach, because I couldn't figure out what the defense was. But you're right. They kind of disguise it a little bit. It starts out, looks like a 3-2, but then it morphs into the 1-3-1. They're a little more aggressive with this 1-3-1 than traditional defenses like that. Now, Xavier's going to have to try to attack it at its weakest points, and that's on the baseline.
All right, so there's big players for both of these teams, but experience is one of those factors. But it's not an experienced player. Both of these coaches have been in this state title game before. But it's a freshman who doesn't have that experience who's huge right now for Xavier.
Showed several of her highlights. Libby Fandel is a fun player to watch. Just a freshman. 15 points a game. She's averaging 8.5 rebounds a game here in the tournament. And she's dishing out 6 assists. So she doesn't just score. She will get her teammates involved. She's got a great running mate in Kayla Mason. Over the last 7 games, she has been hot, averaging 15 points a game. She's a key to this ball game.
All right, Laura Leonard, you'll have the call with BJ Shaben on that Class 4A. Let's go to our middle game of the day and show you the highlights in Class 2A. The Panorama Panthers, they won by 8 over Regina in the quarters to advance. Dyke New Hartford, the Wolverines are the defending champs in 2A, and 4 of their 5 starters are back. Rischel to Peyton Beckman for the 3. And now she'll take it coast to coast. Beckman with 73% of her team's points in the first half. Offense was tough early on for Panorama. Then it was Ellery Knock to Peyton Peterson for the layup, and then Hoffman dishes to Peterson. Gets the layup, draws the foul. Peyton had 12 first half points. Wolverines doubled up in the first half. Lacey Rischel to Peyton Beckman with the 3. And then it's Taylor Cavalli. Cavalli to Hoffman. And then it's going to be in transition. Peterson now putting it back in. As Dyke New Hartford moves on, 67-23. Peterson would finish with 19 points and 11 rebounds. Central Lyon, first trip to state from 2015, needed a buzzer beater to advance. Denver held off Underwood in the quarters. Grace Hennessy, the rebound. And now she's gonna drive. Grace has been great for years. She finished with 8. Kaylee Davis for Central Lyon in transition with the mid-range jumper. Davis scores 8. But a big close for Central Lyon would put them up 26-19, set the tone for the second half. Reese Johnson, nice move in that jumper. And now Avery Ford to Reese Johnson, dead center 3. Kaylee Fluitt, Reagan Van Wy, Addison Klostermore gets the 3. Same spot again. Central Lyon wins 53-35. So Jackie Kalen, we talk about the buzzer beater. We talk about Central Lyon beating number 2. Doesn't sound like the pressure's getting to them. How are they handling it?
Well, this is a group, Paul, that plays extremely loose. They're silly, they have fun, and they're extremely competitive. The way they play resembles their head coach and the way she played. Heather Grafing won a national championship at Northwestern, and she was always at her best when she was out there playing freely. And you can tell that's really the way Addison Klostermore and her teammates play as they look to take down the defending champs.
Let's go back to the coach real quick. Played in the coached as an assistant coach in the old building in the last year, moved across the street to the new building, but every step of the way she said she's learned something about that game. How does that translate to today?
Well, she speaks a lot of her mentorship from Coach Wallstra and her playing days at Northwestern, and she says everything she's learned as a player and, as you mentioned, as a coach just has made her better and better. And all she's looking to do, she said yesterday, was that experience that she felt, that energy from winning a national championship. She wants that so badly for her players today.
And she was real fun to talk to after the semifinals. But let's flip over to Dyke New Hartford now. Sophia Hoffman has had some memorable marches. It's her birthday today. The birthday girl, what would be the ultimate gift for her? Obviously the state championship, but there's a little more to it.
Well, the good news is she's got RSVPs to the party from the Peterson twins. Jaden and Peyton Peterson averaging double-doubles in this tournament. You mentioned earlier, this is a team returning 4 starters from an undefeated season a year ago. They have so many athletes on the team. Sophia Hoffman going on to play college soccer, but basketball was her first love, and there is nothing she would love more than ending her basketball career with a state championship in basketball.
And Hoffman, as a freshman, was contemplating not continuing on with her career, but Coach Dahl had a plan for her. She progressed as the years went on. Last year, she scored a little bit more, but the distribution is key for her.
It is, and she mentioned she's played a lot of different roles for Coach Dahl, but has really bought into dishing it this year, leads the team in assists. does a great job of getting everybody involved and has led the way for this team.
All right, Jackie, I got to go one more here with you. I don't want to take exactly the big story that you're going to talk about with Brad between the coach and the player. Coach Dahl, if he used to be the coach at AGWSR. There's a little bit of a backstory there.
Well, Coach Griffin couldn't believe yesterday we had mentioned that when she was here in 2009, lost in the semis, didn't realize she was facing Coach Dahl at AGWSR. It was so cool seeing the look on her face, realizing she's facing him again today.
And they'll meet in the circle, and we'll show you that pregame in just a couple of minutes. But we have one more game we need to tell you about, and that was in Class 1A. As I flip my papers, we're going to flip the script and show you the highlights to this ball game. MMCRU, that's Marcus Merritt and Claiborne Remsen Union, and Newell Fonda. They've been in the final seven of the last 9 years. They're the three-time defending champions. Emily Dreckman drives in, and then Dreckman gets the one bounce and lays it up. She'd have 18 in the quarters, and then Macy would have 16 in round one, and in 14 in round two. Lacey Hograve there, we were showing you. Now Lainey Hograve with the jump. Hograve would add 10. Newell Fonda led at the break by three. Second half, Newell Fonda. Macy Severs gets the cross-court pass from Bartek. There were nine ties in the game, but this shot from Severs was the last time that Newell Fonda held the lead midway through the third quarter. Here come the Royals. Emily Drackman to Ellie Hillbrands in the jump shot. And then Cora Alish is going to find Hillebrands again with the jumper. Hillebrands with 22. MMCRU wins 66-62. North Lynn, they won the Tri-Rivers Conference battle over Springville in the quarters. Bishop Garrigan sent undefeated Burlington Notre Dame home on Wednesday. Molly Bogey to Cameron Kurt for three. Kurt had 17 in the opener. And in this game, she'd finish with 19. Another nice shot there from Cameron. Molly Joyce inside to Audie Crooks. Crooks had 32 in the opener and was not done. Great shot there right before the buzzer. Garrigan was up 14 at the break. Here come the Lynx. Cameron Kurt to Macy Bogey. Bingo! Hits the three. And then Garrigan corner, Molly Joyce. Her shots have been huge this week. Abby Capetius drives and gets the layup. Molly Joyce to Audie Crooks. Down low, looks a lot like a lot of teams have had to face several times. Audie Crooks going off. Third straight title game appearance for the Golden Bears as they win 74-57. So again, I'm gonna pull on your experience, Laura. You've seen a lot of players. I remember that first year Audie played here as a freshman. People were like, who's this freshman from Garrigan? We gotta see her. We saw her in the championship game. Last year, see her in the championship game. The question I get, and I know you get, how good is Audie Crooks?
She's really good. And she's gotten better from her freshman year to now. She has steadily improved, and that's a scary prospect for all of these teams that have faced her and that are going to have to face her again next year. She has the best hands of any center I have ever seen. All you have to do is throw it up to her. She will go get it, and she can connect. She's shooting over 70% from the floor, so she's gotten better. But the player that gets her the basketball is Molly Joyce. Now, she just doesn't pass her the basketball. She can score, too, 25 points a game in the first two games, but she also will hand out the assists, and she will also get steals. She had seven steals in that first game. That's a big part of what they do.
That defense really kind of wreaks havoc, like you're mentioning. So Joyce is shooting. Why is it so important to have a good outside game when you have a player like Crooks down low?
You got to have the hot shooters from the outside. That opens up things because the defense has to respect that. They have to come out and play it. They can't let Molly Joyce or anybody else stand out there and shoot the basketball uncovered and just sag back on Crooks. They have to go out and cover it, so it gives you good balance.
All right, MMCRU coach Jillian Lecce, former college player at Iowa State and Concordia in Minnesota. She's also been a college coach. She had a high-level game plan in the semifinals. What were the keys to that college-level plan?
It really was a college-level plan, and the players bought into it. They looked at the scouting report, they read it, and they executed. Number one was lockdown defense, and they really did that. They were able to slow them down, get them into a half-court set, which they're not comfortable with. Newell Fonda likes to run, and when you put them in that half-court set, they had a little trouble navigating that. and then read the defense. That's what you need to do. See what the defense is giving you. If they're doing one thing, try to do the opposite. Slip a screen, roll here, and I think you're going to see them do that again today.
First time that we have done all 9 years of this, Laura. This is the first time we're not talking about Newell Fonda or Springville in the finals. It'll be a little bit different for you and BJ.
Yeah, it is definitely going to be different. I mean, you get used to these teams coming year in and year out. You have your prep work already done for you. Now we had to scramble last night because we have a couple new teams.
Which makes it fun, and that's why we play the games. Thank you, Laura Leonard, to be with BJ Shaven, and Jackie will be with Brad Wells. All right, let's go back down to the court for the first time tonight, and we have the All-Iowa dance team.
Let's welcome the All-Iowa Honor Dance Team under the direction of Kathy Inyard as they perform for your pregame entertainment. 50 dancers will perform a hoop routine to a medley of USA songs. The pregame was choreographed by Rachel Wehr and Ella Johnner from Pella. This performance is dedicated to Lois Turnage. Ladies and gentlemen, the All-Iowa Honor Dance Team. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand as we honor America, our military, and their families. The All-Iowa dancers will now perform a patriotic finale featuring all the state flags of our great nation. Ellie Booth from Waverly Shell Rock is the United States flag bearer, and the national anthem will be sung by Jackie Schmellen.
By the dawn's early so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was
thing to see both in person and on television. We will be right back with a full slate of girls high school basketball. Then we're going to have the Class 4A, 2A, and 1A championships, which are coming up next on statewide Iowa PBS.